Is it visible and audible? All clear? Can we start the class? Yes. So, starting with today's topic, it is going to be about glomerular diseases. So, basically nephritic and nephrotic syndrome. Since it is a bit huge topic, I have divided it into two sessions, today and tomorrow. And just like our previous class of vasculitis, have combined both pathology and medicine and have tried to cover whatever is necessary from theory aspect as well as from entrance exam aspect. So how we'll be dealing with today's session, we'll start with some amount of basic anatomy and how mechanism of injury, what is the basic pathogenesis, then how do we assess what are the causes for nephritic and nephrotic syndrome, and we'll do few of nephritic syndromes today. Rest of them we'll deal with it tomorrow. Okay, so this is a plan. Mostly it might take up to an hour. Okay, so starting with the basic anatomy, what do we see? First, there will be efferent arteriole will be there. This efferent arteriole and the glomerulus, and on taking cut section of this glomerulus, what do we see as I've drawn in this image, on taking the cut section, the efferent arteriole, what has gone in, splits into the efferent arteriole will be there. This efferent arteriole will have its endothelium, no? Will have this, its endothelium. So that is what we see over here, is the capillary endothelium, okay? Below that comes the basement membrane, glomerular basement membrane, capillary endothelium, followed by glomerular basement membrane. Following that, what we see is the slit diaphragm. What is this slit diaphragm? It is nothing but the space that is formed by the visceral epithelium, which is present, gives out podocytes. Visceral epithelium that is present gives out podocytes, as we see in this diagram. This is the visceral epithelium. This visceral epithelium gives out podocytes. This is the podocytes. And the space between these podocytes are covered by the slit diaphragm. So we have the slit diaphragm with podocytes. Okay. So after this comes the urinary space is there. After this is the urinary space. After that comes the epithelium comes over here, rectal epithelium. So these are the layers the urine passes through. Once it enters the efferent arteriole, these are the layers the urine has to pass through to form urinary space, and then it goes into the proximal convoluted tubule. So this is important. This can be asked in our exams. This sequence is important. It can be asked in our exams. So then dealing with the structures, first is the glomerular basement membrane. Let's see how this is formed. It has two ends. One is the N-terminal end, and another one is the NC1 domain. So one end is the N-terminal, the other end is the NC1 domain. Okay. And this is the helical structure. It's an alpha helical structure, which is a triple helix. And this helical structure forms the lamina densa, and the supporting structures for this lamina densa is formed by the glycoproteins and the proteoglycans. And these proteoglycans contain certain proteins called as PERLECAN, perlecan and argin. This is what is responsible for the negative charge of the glomerular basement membrane. Why is it important? Why is this negative charge important? It is to repel the positive charge proteins. once there is repelling, there won't, so important proteins like albumin are not lost because of the repelling power. Okay, that is why this negative charge on the basement membrane is important. Okay, next we see what is this laminar densa made of. Again, very important, it is made of collagen type 4. This forms a triple helical structure, and this is of 6 types. This collagen is of 6 types, okay, basically 6 types. Alpha chains, 6 types of alpha chains are there, alpha 1 to alpha 6. Again, why is this important? Why is this alpha chains, collagen, alpha chains that is present in the collagens are of 6 types? Why is it important? Again, because specific structures, if they are mutated, they cause some amount of this, they cause this nephritic or nephrotic picture. It's just, for example, we have collagen A5. If collagen A5 is affected, what is the disease that takes place? And again, if NC1 domain is affected, what is the disease that takes place? Anyone can answer this question? Yes, very good. Okay, this forms alports. Okay. This forms, yes, good. This forms anti-GBM or anti-GBM or good pasture. Okay, so that is the important of knowing this structure. Okay, next, let's see the structure of slit diaphragm. Slit diaphragm. Slit diaphragm was the, when there is the space between the two podocytes are covered by slit diaphragm. This is what we had mentioned. So what are, it is made up of certain proteins. These proteins can be, one can be the nephrin molecule as shown one here. It can be nephrin molecules. These forms the nephrin molecules. And these nephrin molecules are held by the podocytes. How are they held? One is by the CD2A protein, CD2A protein, and another one is by podocin. Okay, another one is by podocin. And there are certain actin filaments. Again, why is this important? Why is it important to know this? Because certain structures can be mutated, which can lead to nephrotic or nephritic syndrome. As we see, if there is mutation in nephrin molecule, what happens? Yes, very good. Congenital nephrin molecules, podocin, all these things can get affected, and it can cause congenital nephrotic syndrome or Finnish type. Very good, very good. Or Finnish type, okay? Finnish type. So that is the importance of knowing this, okay? So next there is visceral epithelium. Visceral epithelium, they contain certain amount of fenestration, okay? This fenestration size is important. Size of this visceral epithelium fenestration is important, around 70 to 100 nanometer in diameter. Again, this visceral endothelium, sorry, not the visceral epithelium, the capillary endothelium. Capillary endothelium is fenestrated, and it is 70 to 100 nanometer in diameter. Okay, that amount of fenestration is present for the molecules to pass through, and it is negatively charged as well. And again, the protein responsible for this negative charge is important, that is podocalyxin. Okay, so this whole glomerulus is supported by what? Supported by the mesangial cell and the mesangial matrix. So this was the picture of the glomerulus. There is efferent arteriole and efferent arteriole growing out. Then comes the glomerulus is formed. This glomerulus from inside to outside will have capillary endothelium. Then comes the glomerular basement membrane. Then comes the slit diaphragm with the podocytes. Then there is the urinary space. Outside is the parietal epithelium forming the Bowman's capsule. Okay. And in between, it contains the supportive structures, which is nothing but mesangium, mesangial cells along with mesangial matrix. So this was to do with the basic anatomy. So because of these structures and this small amount of space present, they limit the solutes to pass through. Only the plasma will be filtered. Solutes won't be filtered. Okay. So what does that lead to? What does that lead to? So if it is less than 4 mm solute size, it will be filtered. It will be filtered. If it is greater than 8 mm, it won't be filtered. It will not be filtered. If it is 4 to 8 mm, then based on the charge, as we saw, there were certain proteins giving negative charge. based on this charge, it will be filtered. That is the importance. Okay. So next, let's see the mechanism leading to the injury. Okay. Mostly, it is the immune-mediated cell injury takes place. As we saw in last class, vasculitis, or here as well, immune-mediated cell injury takes place. But how does this immune-mediated cell injury take place? One can be because of immune complex is already formed in the circulation that goes and gets deposited, okay? That goes and gets deposited. And how is this immune complex formed? It can either be because of endogenous or exogenous antigen. Endogenous like glomerular basement membrane, antigen to against that is formed. Those antigen antibody complex goes and gets deposited. Or it can be because of exogenous, certain infectious agents, all those things will go get deposited and will lead to deposition. And this on immunofluorescence, this will show up. On immunofluorescence, it will show. Similarly, it can be because of in situ antigen as well. This in situ antigens, what can it be? Intrinsic tissues wherein the glomerular structures itself will have altered antigens which will be detected foreign by our body and antibody goes and acts against it. That can be in case of NC1 domain of collagen 4, this you guys already told, or PLA2R antigen. If antibody is directed against this, what disease do we get? What are we expected to find? Or it can be against mesangial antigen. Yes, very good. Membranous nephropathy. Okay. Or it is something can be Heymann nephritis. What is Heymann nephritis? Anyone? Do you guys know? Hey, if Heymann nephritis. Anyone aware of Heymann nephritis? Against what antigen was it? What was the antigen detected in Heymann nephritis? Heymann nephritis is nothing but its animal counterpart of membranous nephropathy itself. When they were doing studies, I think so, in rats, similar to PLA2R antigen, they found something called as megalin antigen. Megalin was the antigen found in the rats. Mostly it's rats. I forgot the animal. It is mostly the rats. When they were doing study, they found antigen against this. Led to something called as Heymann nephritis. And the human counterpart for that was PLA2R antigen causing the membranous nephropathy. This was intrinsic tissues, or it can be planted antigen again from outside. Again, similarly antigen, exogenous or endogenous. Or it can be ANCA-mediated, like we saw day before yesterday, while doing vasculitis, few of them led to involvement of glomerulus causing nephritic or nephrotic picture. Correct, no? That was because of ANCA-mediated vasculitis. If it is ANCA-mediated vasculitis, it will be posi-immune. Posi-immune means there won't be any deposition. This anti-neutrophilic cytoplasmic antibody itself goes and causes, these antibodies cause direct injury to the glomerulus. There won't be any antibody deposition, antigen antibody deposition. That's why it is called as posi immune, because they cause direct toxicity to the cell. Okay. So when this takes place, when this immune complex mediated damage takes place to the glomerulus, our body reacts to this. How does our body react to this? By producing chronic inflammation. Inflammation will be produced by our body that will lead to nephritic or nephrotic picture. Okay, that will lead to nephritic or nephrotic picture, as we see in this flowchart. Chronic inflammatory illness will be formed in case of nephrotic, or it can be acute in nature, like acute nephritic syndrome. And this will be the response as we see in this image. And once our body responds to this injury, what are the changes we are expected to see in the kidney? Is this one kidney can respond to this by hypercellularity? Because why hypercellularity? Because there will be inflammatory mediators come in. No, once the inflammatory mediators come in, there will be infiltration by leukocytes. Once these infiltration leukocytes comes and hit the endothelial cells, there will be irritation. Once there is irritation, that causes proliferation of mesangial and endothelial cells that will lead to hypercellularity, nothing but endocapillary proliferation, or it can lead to crescent formation. Why crescent formation? Because plasma proteins and exudates come in, they come irritate the parietal epithelium. It will lead to proliferation of this parietal epithelium, which will lead to crescent formation. Where is crescent formation seen? In which type of nephropathy? Where is crescent formation seen? Yes, RPGN. RPGN, we see crescent formation. Next, there can be basement membrane thickening. How else kidney will respond to this? Kidney can respond to this by causing basement membrane thickening. Okay, in this, there will be immune complex deposition. Why basement membrane thickening takes place is, those immune complex which we saw over here, either direct immune complex or antigen antibody comes and attacks this. And where do they get deposited? They get deposited in the basement membrane, making it appear thickened. So it will be thickened. Okay. Or it can be because of the similar to this picture, these leukocytes come in, or the inflammatory mediators, or these leukocytes come in and start irritating the basement membrane, which will lead to proliferation of basement membrane itself, which leads to increased component of basement membrane protein or basement membrane duplication. Next, there can be hyalinosis or sclerosis. And most often it's mistaken to be synonymous, but no, both are different. Can you guys tell the difference between hyalinosis and sclerosis? What is hyalinosis? What is sclerosis? Anyone? Okay. What is the hyaline tissue? Sclerosis is collagen tissue. Agreed. Yes, hyalinosis is proteinaceous deposits that is nothing but produced by plasma proteins. That is nothing but produced by the plasma proteins. Okay. Or it can be sclerosis. Yes, good. Or it can be sclerosis wherein there is collagenous material deposition. Collagenous material deposition leads to sclerosis. Okay. So this is how the kidney reacts to this. So once this happens, there will be damage produced. So where will the damage be produced? To the anatomical structures which we read now. So this damage can be to glomerular basement membrane. And most often when there is damage to the glomerular basement membrane, glomerular basement membrane mainly acts as the mechanical barrier. Once there is mechanical barrier, what happens? All the blood components come into the urine, causing hematuria, or these plasma proteins, again, which were prevented by the glomerular basement membrane by acting as a mechanical barrier, they also come in out, causing casts, and again, blood components causing RBC casts. Plasma, again, it can cause non-selective proteinuria as well. Why not albumin? Because albumin, the size of albumin is between 4 to 8 mm. When the size is less than 4 mm, it gets filtered out. If the size is greater than 8 mm, it will be prevented. But if it is in between, we saw that it depends on the charge of the protein. So albumin is lodged if there is injury to the podocytes. Okay. If there is injury to the podocytes. How does podocyte prevent is? Podocytes are usually negatively charged. So by repelling the anions, they prevent the entry. So when that happens, proteins like albumin or lipoprotein or certain antithrombotic factors like protein C, protein S or antithrombin 3 come out or pass out through the urine. This will lead to gross albuminuria or dyslipidemia, or it will lead to hypercoagulable state, okay? Because of loss of albumin, we'll have gross albuminuria. Lipoprotein is lost, so there is nothing to bind to the VLDL and LDL synthesized, that will lead to hypercholesterolemia or dyslipidemia. And since antithrombotic factors are lost, we'll have hypercoagulable state. So when the predominant injury is towards GBM, we can tell that there will be nephritic picture. And if the predominant injury is towards the podocyte, we can have nephrotic picture. We can have nephrotic picture. Okay. So what we read till now, we saw the basic anatomy, and then we saw how certain immune complex mediated damage. We saw the anatomy, then how immune complex mediated damage will cause inflammatory state, This will cause, this inflammatory mediators released by the body causes secondary changes in the kidney, Correct, no? These changes in terms of increased cellularity or hyalinosis and sclerosis. Hyalinosis or sclerosis can be there. All these things will lead to structural damage to the kidney in terms of GBM or podocyte. So whichever thing gets predominantly affected, it causes that picture. Nephritic or nephrotic picture will be seen. So this is what we saw, the basic introduction. So next, how do we assess? One, we can assess pathologically using light microscopy, wherein we use HNE stain, patch stain, or certain special stains like silver stains, mainly to see the GBM. So anyone can answer this question, which among the following are past positive structures in kidney, in the glomerulus, which of the following are past positive structures? Okay, since more than one can be right, some one of you, them are telling basement membrane. Okay, correct. Yes, very good. Mesangium. Next. Anything else? It's a PGA type. Anyone else would like to answer? Okay, Bowman's capsule, very good. Next, anything else? Basically, all the five structures. These are the five structures which are past positive, okay? Which are past positive and used to study, okay? So next we can use immunofluorescence and electron microscopy. And clinically, how do we see? Clinically, how do we evaluate the patient? We'll see it through these two cases. First one is a 35-year-old male patient who comes with complaints of malaise, anorexia, headache, flank pain, and passage of red color urine, or it's called as cola colored urine. Okay. BP was elevated, mild edema was present, and urine output was reduced. Okay. So that means the picture is acute. It's acute in onset, and the patient is going towards renal failure. Lab reports also indicate the same, because there is increased serum creatinine, EGFR is reduced, okay, and very mild proteinuria is present. Urine shows RBC casts. So this is the first one. This is how we approach the patient clinically in case of glomerular disease based on these clinical features. So first case scenario points towards what? And we'll look at the second case scenario. A 32-year-old male patient woke up early morning and noticed that his right limbs were paralyzed, okay? But this condition eventually improved by afternoon, okay? So he came to hospital for workup. On examination, he has generalized edema and his BP was elevated. Lab reports revealed lipid profiles were elevated, albumin levels were decreased, and GFR was within normal limits. Urine routine showed proteinuria. Gross proteinuria was present. So what is the first case scenario and what is the second case scenario? Anyone? Based on these clinical features, we'll evaluate the patient into the two things. Yes. First one was nephritic. So second one will be nephrotic. So how do we assess the patient? One, we assess him clinically based on these clinical features and the lab. And then if biopsy is indicated, we further go ahead, do biopsy and look for light microscopy staining, immunofluorescence, and electron microscopy. So these are the things which we expect. Most of them, like, there can be overlap, because most of them, since I told GBM, if it's predominantly involved, one thing presents, nephritic presents. If podocytes are predominantly involved, nephrotic presents. So there can be overlap of features, because one can be predominantly affected, but there can't be something like only that is affected. So there can be overlap of features can be seen. So if it is predominantly nephrotic syndrome, we see massive proteinuria defined as greater than 3.5 gram per day per 1.70 meter square. Hypoalbuminemia can be there. Edema can be there. Next, there can be hyperlipidemia. Next, there can be hypercoagulable state can be there. Hypercoagulable state can be there. What is the cause of edema? Anyone? Cause of edema? There are two, three causes. Which is the main mechanism? Main mechanism for the edema. Like in an MCQ, if you get, yes, proteinuria is there. Proteinuria is there. Loss of protein is there. But it is, yeah, that was important. If you get an MCQ and if they ask you to choose which is the most appropriate answer, yes, overfill and underfill theory is there. Very good, Spoorthy. But in an MCQ, if they ask you to mark one, then it will be RAS activation leading to Na plus H2O retention. This is only overfill theory. This is only overfill theory, okay? So there can be underfill theory also because of hypoalbuminemia, but if asked in an MCQ, please mark this. Then comes nephritic, there will be hematuria will be there, hypertension will be there, rapid decline in GFR will be there because it will be an acute nephritic picture, and mild proteinuria will be there. Mild proteinuria will be there, less than 3.5 grams per day per 1.73 meter square. Now let's look into the etiology. So acute nephritic syndrome. This table is taken from Harrison. So very important. This can be asked in our MCQs. Which of them causes nephritic? Which of them cause nephrotic? Or name one option that doesn't cause nephritic, or name one option that doesn't cause nephrotic. It can come like this. So please do remember PSGN, subacute bacterial endocarditis, important. Lupus nephritis. Anti-GBM, nothing but Goodpasture syndrome. IgA nephropathy, ANCA-mediated vasculitis. This is nothing but quasi-immune. HSP, again, HSP as well causes IgA nephropathy only. Then comes cryoglobulinemia and membranoproliferative, MPGN. MPGN, okay. Next comes nephrotic syndrome. Nephrotic syndrome is caused by minimal change disease, FSGS, MGN, diabetic nephropathy, amyloidosis, light chain deposition disease, like then comes Fabry's disease. So remember these things. Okay, remember these things. And when it is antibodies are directed against basement membrane, it can cause Alport syndrome, anti-GBM disease, thin basement membrane disease, and nail patella syndrome. If the one that is directed against the glomerular basement membrane is directed against the pulmonary capillaries also, these diseases can be formed, like Goodpasture syndrome, ANCA-mediated, HSP, and cryoglobulinemia. Okay, so let's look into nephritic syndrome today. So we'll see two cases, both involving a kid, young kid, who presents with nephritic picture. And on asking history, he had a history of URTI, upper respiratory tract infection. Now he comes with nephritic picture 5 days after this, and one more kid comes with the same history but 2 weeks after the infection. What will be the first case? What will be the second case? Yes, very good. Usually IgA nephropathy presents 1 week, within one week of infection, and there will be recurrent history, and this will be recurrent also. It can be recurrent also. Okay. He'll be having microscopic hematuria. In general, the kid will be having microscopic hematuria, which will not be detected, but on having a stress factor, it will become macroscopic hematuria and he comes. So it can be a recurrent history. And this one, usually less than 3 weeks of infection, skin or respiratory tract infection, they present. PSGN presents. Okay. So let's look into post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Okay. This is the first disease entity. Epidemiology, usually it involves the kids, 2 to 14 year kids, males and females are equally affected. What is the etiology? Most common etiology being post-streptococcal. This is the most common. And what are the strains? The lower strains like 1, 2, 3, 4 usually comes after an episode of pharyngitis, 1 to 3 weeks after pharyngitis. The higher strains like 47, 14 and 55 comes 2 to 3 weeks after skin infection. Then subacute bacterial endocarditis, important. This as well can cause PSGN. And these are the other infections that can cause PSGN. If it involves adults, what is the difference is, in kids, it is immunocompetent kids. But if it involves adults, it is usually in case of immunocompromised adults. Immunocompromised adults usually suffer from PSGN. One more important point is, yes, immunocompromised states like diabetes mellitus, very important. Good. One more important point is, it is usually MRSA strains. And last point, very important is, they have bad prognosis. They have very bad prognosis. They'll progress to RPGN, usually RPGN type 2. They'll progress to RPGM type 2 and failure. And they might land up in failure. That's why if it is kids, it will usually resolve. Okay. So we don't progress to biopsy. If it is adults, we directly do a biopsy. That is the basic difference. Okay. What is the pathogenesis? As we saw, it can be immune complex deposits, antigen antibody come and deposit, or it can be circulating antigen coming and getting deposited, which will lead to complement activation and cell mediated injury. Okay. Activation of these complements lead to the finding of low serum complement levels. What we measure in the blood is low C3 levels. Okay. This will lead to inflammatory picture, glomerulonephritis, acute nephritic picture will be there. And we saw that there is circulating antigen or immune complex deposition towards the antigen in the glomerulus. What are these antigenic component that triggers the inflammation, which causes molecular mimicry? One is streptococcal pyrogenic exotoxin B, antibody against this streptococcal pyrogenic exotoxin B. One more is nephritis associated plasminogen receptor. Okay, important. This can be asked in the MCQ. These two antigens are important. These two antigens may cause molecular mimicry. Okay, next we look into morphology. Morphology on light microscopy, you will find hypercellularity will be there. As we saw how the kidney responds. No, it responds by causing hypercellularity. One is diffuse hypercellularity involving the endothelial proliferation will be more. Second one is infiltration by the leukocytes. This on seeing through electron microscopy, what do we see? We'll see the same hypercellularity. We'll see infiltration by leukocytes. Okay. Then you will have immune complex deposition. This immune complex deposition initially is subendothelial. That will again go further and cause subepithelial deposits. In terms of the deposits, usually take place in this manner, causing what you see as humps, camel hump appearance or subepithelial humps. This is characteristic of this disease. Immunofluorescence will show granular pattern with IgG, C3, IgM, all these things. Okay. So clinical feature will be nephritic picture will be there. Cola colored urine will be there. Then there can be other non-constitutional symptoms like headache, anorexia, flank pain, and all. Flank pain is because of stretching of the renal capsule. Okay, so lab will show low C3 levels, anti-DNAs, antibodies, anti-streptococcal O titers will be there, or anti-hyaluronidase antibody titers will be positive. Treatment is usually supportive, and you just monitor for all the monitor the vitals, look for progression of edema, and in case if required, dialysis we do, control the hypertension, and treat the infection. Antibiotic treatment in terms of penicillin or erythromycin if the patient is allergic is given. And we usually see complete resolution in 3 to 6 weeks, in case children are infected, because less than 1% progress to end stage renal disease. So how do we see it in terms of lab is C3 levels will return to normal maximum within 8 weeks. Within 8 weeks, C3 levels return to normal. Okay. If they don't return to normal, in kids, we do biopsy. But in case of adults, since they carry poor prognosis, we directly do a biopsy and see what has happened. As we see, 60% of them will progress to ESRD. Okay. So this was about PSGN. Next, we'll see IgA nephropathy. It is also called as Buerger's disease. Buerger's disease is nothing but TAO. This we read in vasculitis, thromboangitis obliterans. We read about it in vasculitis. We look at IgA nephropathy. This presents in middle age, males being more affected. It is also speculated to be post-infectious. Post-infectious, again, molecular mimicry can be one of the cause, less than 1 week following a SP or GI infection. So what happens is there are IgA, what we see is of two types. One is monomeric, another one is polymeric, okay? This monomeric is produced by bone marrow. This is polymeric is produced by usually the lymphoid tissue. Usually mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue produces these polymeric antibodies. So, and these are cleared by the liver. So one primary cause wherein the etiology is not known, it can be usually molecular mimicry post-infectious state. And there are certain secondary disorders wherein IgA nephropathy is caused. When does that happen? When either this liver is not clearing these polymeric IgA proteins, or when these smart tissues produce abnormal IgA proteins, which is nothing but aberrant glycosylation of IgA1, abnormal IgA1 proteins, which are not being able to clear by the liver. Okay. This is the pathogenesis. So it is seen in increased frequency in people with celiac disease, IBD, all those things, because mucosa is affected, no? In this, smart tissue will be affected. Or liver disease, wherein they don't clear these proteins. Pathogenesis, aberrant glycosylation of IgA1. So since it is not cleared, this IgA1 comes and deposits in the kidney. In the glomeruli, they deposit, or IgG reacts against IgA1. And form immune complex deposition. Usually, there is mesangial deposits. They'll go and get deposited in the mesangium. Okay. So morphology, what do we see? Since there is mesangial deposition, it will cause proliferation of the mesangial tissue. So mesangial proliferation. The electron microscopy as well shows mesangial deposits. So this is what we see: mesangial proliferation along with mesangial IgA deposition. Okay. Mesangial IgA deposition. And this biopsy finding is given by a criteria called as MEST-C criteria. As we saw, there is mesangial hypercellularity. Then there can be endocapillary hypercellularity. Most of the time, there will be mesangial hypercellularity, but some amount of endocapillary hypercellularity can also be there. If the disease doesn't resolve and further progresses, it can lead to RPGN picture. In very few of them. If there is RPGN picture, then there can be all these things, all these further findings can be there, like segmental glomerulosclerosis can be there, tubular atrophy or interstitial fibrosis can be there, or crescent formation will take place. Finally, it can lead to crescent formation. There will be progressive renal damage, finally, which will lead to crescent formation. So this is given by the criteria. Okay, next we'll look at the clinical features. Clinical features, it is usually a benign disease. So most of the time, the patient will be having microscopic hematuria. And in case of stressor like infection, he will come off with macroscopic hematuria along with proteinuria. So rarely the patient might end up in acute renal failure. As we see, 5 to 30% will go into complete remission, and very small amount of people might progress to slow renal failure. As we saw over here, slow renal failure they might progress to, okay? So since the disease is self-limiting, you control hypertension and proteinuria by giving ACE inhibitors. If proteinuria is persistent for more than 6 months, then it is an indication for steroid treatment. Okay. So now let's look into the next one. Next cause of nephritic syndrome, that is lupus nephritis. Lupus nephritis, depending on the type of the disease, let's see how lupus nephritis is. It is mainly because of deposition of anti-double-stranded DNA antibodies, okay, on the GBM. As we see in lupus nephritis, there is anti-double-stranded DNA antibodies present. This goes and deposits in the GBM, causing the disease. And one more thing, which is pathognomy cause, over here and all, low C3 was present, but it improved gradually. But over here, it will be persistently low C3 levels is pathognomic of lupus nephritis. So as the disease progresses, we'll see. One and two are not active disease. So the patient remains asymptomatic. So there will be mesangial proliferation will be there, but the case is not active. That means patient is asymptomatic. When there is less than 50% involvement, you can call it as minimal mesangial proliferative disease. If it is greater than 50% involvement, it can be diffuse. Okay. So there will be asymptomatic proteinuria or microhematuria will be there with normal GFR. For this, no active treatment is required because the patient will be asymptomatic. Further, if the disease progresses, then we'll have focal nephritis or diffuse nephritis. The only difference between these two is if greater than 50% of glomerulus is involved, then we can call it as diffuse. Over here, patient presents with nephritic picture. Okay. Since most of the patients with SLV come within 3 or 4, we can tell that lupus nephritis, if they ask in MCQ, lupus nephritis causes which among them, then you can call it as MPGN or nephritic type, but it can cause any of them. It can cause, as the disease progresses, we see that it can cause either nephritic or nephrotic picture. If he lies within 3 and 4, now the patient was asymptomatic over here. Now he'll become an active case. Because active disease will be there, patient becomes symptomatic. So what is the pathogenesis? Pathogenesis is membranoprogressive glomerulonephritis, which will lead to thickening of basement membrane. We'll look at this disease entity later. On immunofluorescence, there will be granular deposition of all immunoglobulins and complement. Very important is all immunoglobulins and complement, which will lead to something called as full house immunofluorescence. So lupus nephritis leads to full house immunofluorescence. Okay. And on electron microscopy, since there will be immune complex deposition, there will be, in case of MPGN, we see subendothelial immune complex deposition. Then we see in case of SLE, we see something again characteristic called as wire loop lesions. And on doing electron microscopy, we find fingerprint or thumbprint appearance. In case, treatment for this is IV methylprednisolone pulse therapy. Since it's an emergency and patient can progress to RPGN and renal failure, we give IV methylprednisolone pulse therapy is given. You want me to repeat this. So see, lupus nephritis, lupus nephritis, it's a continuous disease entity. It progresses from type 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. 1 and 2 is asymptomatic. The patient doesn't have any symptoms over there. The kidney will be slowly being involved, but still the patient is not symptomatic. Over here, there'll be mesangio. What is the pathology in that? Will be mesangio proliferative pattern. This, if it's less than 50% is involved, it is minimal. If greater than 50% is involved, it will be diffuse. Okay. So since the patient is asymptomatic, he might have some amount of microhematuria only. No active treatment is required. Okay. If the disease progresses, then there will be nephritis, focal nephritis or diffuse nephritis. Again, diffuse is greater than 50% involvement. What is the pathology over here? Pathology is MPGN, membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. We'll see what MPGN is in our next is MPGN. Next discussion will be about MPGN. So MPGN, what will be the clinical feature? Clinical feature will be nephritic picture. Okay. So on doing immunofluorescence, if we do a biopsy and look for immunofluorescence, we'll find granular. But what is characteristic is the immune complex deposition will contain all the immunoglobulins and all the complements. That's why it is called as full house immunofluorescence. Okay. On doing electron microscopy, there'll be subendothelial deposits, via loop lesions. Sorry, on doing electron microscopy, you'll have fingerprint appearance or thumbprint appearance. On doing light microscopy, we can find subendothelial deposits and via loop lesions. Okay. Since the patient might progress to renal failure, in this case only sudden renal failure, to avoid that, we give IV methylprednisolone pulse therapy. Okay. Next, if the disease further progresses, then we'll have type 5, that is nothing but membranous nephropathy. Membranous nephropathy, we'll study about this in detail. Clinical features will be of nephrotic syndrome. Treatment over here is oral steroids. Pathology over here, subepithelial deposits you find. And the last one is advanced sclerosing type, wherein the patient has already reached end-stage renal disease, is already having chronic kidney injury. So the only treatment over here is dialysis or transplant. Okay. Over here, greater than 90% of glomerulus is involved. And most common cause of acute mortality in SLE is this. Okay. Kidney involvement, mainly type 3 or type 4. Type 4 mainly. Type 4. Okay. That is the most common cause of acute mortality. Is on treatment, yeah, that is how you assess the treatment. It will come back to normal. Okay, next. Okay, since we have time, we'll look at this one last thing. So again, next, we'll look at this case scenario. A patient is suffering from a solid organ malignancy. Like we can tell the patient is suffering from a liver tumor or a breast cancer. Okay, then he presents with hematuria, pyuria, proteinuria, fatigability and malaise. Then we see that the patient rapidly progresses to RPGN pattern on doing biopsy and he went into renal failure. Again, we'll see a second patient with the same solid organ malignancy. He presented with anasarca, proteinuria, microscopic hematuria. On doing GFR and CM creatinine, they were normal. And he's had 2 to 3 such episodes. In the past 1 year, he's had 2 to 3 such episodes. Now he has come with complaints of this from 2 days, from this from a week. He's been complaining of this from a week. And from past 1 day, he's having this chest pain and breathlessness. From past 1 day, he's having this. What is this and what is this? Case 1 is what? Case 2 is what? Okay, Pooja Shri, good. This is membranous nephropathy. Membranous nephropathy has led to what? What is the complication over here? What is the complication over here? Yes, thrombosis, mainly suspecting a pulmonary embolism over here. Pulmonary
embolism. Okay, very good. This one, case one, what is case one? Since both of them had solid organ malignancy, which is the nephritic that is mostly associated with the solid organ malignancy, and which is a nephrotic picture mostly associated with solid organ malignancy? No, this is a simple case of MPGN, and this is membranous nephropathy. So MPGN usually presents with nephritic, predominantly nephritic, we can tell, and MN predominantly nephrotic. So let's look into MPGN, membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. Again, middle-aged people, males being more commonly affected. And previously, MPGN was classified as type 1 disease, type 2 disease, and type 3 disease. But now type 2 and type 3 is a different entity. It has been separated from MPGN, and we have type 1 only. Okay, type 1 disease. Type 1 disease, what are the causes? One is primary idiopathic, reason not known. Second one being SABE can cause MPGN. SLE, as we saw, type 3 and type 4 caused MPGN. Then cryoglobulinemia following hepatitis C can cause this. Mixed cryoglobulinemia, like in case of multiple myeloma, can cause this. Hepatitis B can cause, and solid organ malignancy. As we saw in our case, solid organ malignancy also can cause. Okay. And certain parasitic infections like Plasmodium, malaria, schistosoma, and all can cause MPGN. Type 2 disease, which is presently called as dense deposit disease. Over here, what is the cause? We'll see the cause in the pathogenesis for type 2 disease. Type 1 disease pathogenesis is immune complex deposition leading to damage. Type 2 disease, which is nothing but dense deposit disease, what happens is there is excessive activation of alternate complement pathway. Why is this? Because there will be autoantibody against C3 convertase, and this autoantibody activates, constitutive activation of C3 convertase will be there by the autoantibody. This autoantibody is called as C3 nephritic factor. Okay, so what happens because C3 convertase is always active, it will lead to low C3 levels in the blood, but other complements are normal. Complements being activated from classical complement pathway will be normal. C1q, C4 are normal, but C3 levels will be reduced. Okay. Or there can be peripheral receptor deficiency. Complement receptor deficiency can be there, as in type 3 disease. Okay. So next, coming to the morphology. On light microscopy, we have basement membrane thickening will be there. On light microscopy, we can see basement membrane thickening, and we can see hypercellular glomerulus. And what is characteristic for this disease? You will see something called as segmental splitting. See, this is one segment. We see something called as segmental splitting. This is the characteristic morphology for MPGN. On doing special stain, silver stain. This is mainly for GBM, no? Basement membrane, no? What does basement membrane show? Basement membrane show double counter or tram track appearance. Why does this happen? Because of duplication of the basement membrane. On doing electron microscopy, most of the nephritic and nephrotic have subepithelial deposition. Only MPGN comes with MPGN type 1 comes with subendothelial deposition. That's why this is important. This can be asked as an MCQ. Rest all is subepithelial deposition. Only MPGN is subendothelial deposition. Okay. And in case of dense deposit disease, we'll have intramembranous deposition. So, and you have splitting of basement membrane, because the mesangial matrix, there'll be proliferation. No, this mesangial matrix goes and interposes, causing splitting of the basement membrane. So this is the finding. One, we can have duplication of the basement membrane. Two, we can have subendothelial deposition. Very important, it is endothelial deposition. And then we can have intramembranous deposition. Intramembranous deposition in case of type 2. This is type 1. And we'll have splitting of basement membrane because of interposition of the mesangial matrix. Immunofluorescence, again granular pattern will be there, and IgG and C3 will be deposited. Clinical features, predominantly nephritic picture will be there. 25% of patients will progress to RPGN and renal failure. And few of them will have a slow course, slowly progressive disease leading to end-stage renal disease within 10 years. Treatment, treat the underlying disease. If proteinuria presents, give ACE inhibitors. We can as well treat the patient with steroids, cyclophosphamide, plasma exchange, and other immunosuppressive drugs also can be tried. If this patient progresses to ESRD and transplantation is done, we see that there is increased chance of recurrence. There is high chances of recurrence in this patient. So since it's almost an hour, I think so we'll stop over here today. And the rest of nephritic syndrome and nephrotic syndrome, we'll do it tomorrow. Is that fine? It's since we've done it for an hour, it might be difficult to concentrate more. So let's do it tomorrow. Any doubts for today's class?